ओम श्री गुरुभ्यो नमः। सदाशिव संभारंभां शंकराचार्य मध्यमां अस्मदाचार्य पर्यंतां वंदे गुरु परंपरा। नमस्कार टू ऑल। अ वॉर्म वेलकम टू एवरीवन टू द फिफ्थ एडिशन ऑफ द ग्लोबल फेस्टिवल ऑफ वननेस। दिस इज अ मंथ लॉन्ग फेस्टिवल ऑन आदि शंकराचार्य भगवत पादा कवरिंग वेरियस एस्पेक्ट्स एंड टॉपिक्स ऑफ अद्वैत वेदांता। टुडेज टॉपिक इज द
वेदांत
मीन्स ऑफ नॉलेज बाय स्वामी रामेश्वर नंदा सरस्वती जी।
रामेश्वरानंदा
रामेश्वर नंदा सरस्वती जी, इज दैट राइट?
या
वी आर ब्लेस्ड बाय योर प्रेजेंस एंड माई हम्बल प्रणाम्स टू यू स्वामी जी। अ ब्रीफ इंट्रोडक्शन ऑन स्वामी जी। स्वामी जी टुक संन्यास दीक्षा फ्रॉम स्वामी साक्षात्कार नंदा सरस्वती जी, द चीफ आचार्य एट द स्वामी दयानंद सरस्वती आश्रम इन ऋषिकेश। स्वामी जी करेंटली रिसाइड्स एट मंजुकुड़ी, द बर्थ प्लेस ऑफ पूज्य स्वामी दयानंद सरस्वती जी। देर ही ओवरसीज द वेदांता स्टडी सेंटर ज्ञान प्रभावा, वेर ऑल पूज्य श्री स्वामी जीज टीचिंग्स हैव बीन आर्काइव्ड एंड आर अवेलेबल फॉर फ्री एक्सेस टू वेदांता स्टूडेंट्स। Swamiji is associated with Ashra Vidya Research and Publication Trust, founded by Pujya Swamiji, where he publishes Swamiji's teachings. He also produces transcripts for performing the edits of Swami Dayanand Saraswati Ji's teachings and also gets them printed and published and makes them available for students of Vedanta. With that introduction, over to you, Swamiji.
Yes, welcome to all participants in this evening session. It's a very humbling thing to be part of a month-long festival beginning with Shankara Jayanti yesterday. And I have been participating in these sessions in the last 3 years. So Dikha Moksha has been doing a yeoman service in that respect in disseminating Shankara Prabhupada's teaching through the acharyas in the parampara and making it available for general public in two sessions, morning sessions basically on the text and evening session making it available in a more communicable language and making it relevant for the larger public, which is very relevant, which our own acharyas, Pujya Swami Dayanand Saraswati and his guru, Swami Chinmayananda, were really the pioneers in that direction in terms of taking it to the public. So that has taken root and taken in different forms. And this organization also, Indica Moksha also, I'm very happy that they are doing the same. Now, to get to the topic, today's topic, the evening topic being Vedanta and means of self-knowledge, as a means of self-knowledge. So I will brief the beginning and then get into the details. Vedanta, see, by the etymology of it can be said that Anta meaning the end portion of Vedas. Veda is a body of knowledge, a large body of knowledge compiled by Veda Vyasa among the four Vedas. And basically, they are all compiled from by the inspired rishis in different points in time in history. Whatever they have, what you call, seen as truth has been documented in various palm leaves and other things, subsequently in book form and all that. That has been compiled by Vyasa, and from there the end portion, that is the Vedanta part of it, also is the compiled part of the compilation. He has placed it, taking the relevant mantras which can be part of a Upanishad, which can be talking about the Tatparya of the Vedas, not so much about the various procedures on how to live. Veda is a procedure for how to live for those in Vedic times, how the society was. Accordingly, Vedas were compiled on the mantras were there. And this Vedanta is supposed to be giving a sort of an essence or the learnings at the end of a fulfilled life for a person who has lived a Vedic life. So that is, so these mantras and these Upanishad mantras, which are generally called Vedanta, are supposed to be giving us a condensed or an essence on what life is all about. So it gives you a wholesome understanding of life at the end of a Vedic, having lived a Vedic life. So, like any book or any big epic, generally anta meaning may be called the end portion, or it can be called an, what you call the antimannare. What is tatpurya? What is the theme? What is the storyline? What is the, at the end of the day, what the book reveals? So, antima nirnaya also can be the meaning for anta, Vedanta. So, if you draw the meaning from like Gita, nasate vidyate bhavaha, na bhavo vidyate sataha, uveyorabhi drishta antaha, tu anayoho tattva darshibihi. So, am I supposed to save this? What is this? Confirm your speaking language is English. It shows a message. Should I save? Okay. So, yes. So, that Vyorabhi Drishta Antaha, there the Bhasha is, Antaha is Antima Nirnaya, or what do you call with dharana, in the sense, in terms of understanding the whole subject matter of Gita, and in terms of this particular verse, what it tries to convey, Upayoravi drishta antaha tu anayoho tattva darshibi. So the anta meaning is antima nirnaya, avadharanam, satya avadharanam, samyag avadharanam. That can be the meaning for the word anta in Vedanta also. So that way, it gives a more eloquent, more profound meaning for the word Vedanta. So, and also, like, once you say that, it gives the antima nirnaya and what you call satyam avadharanam, samyak avadharanam of the sastra essence. Then you need not say that it is placed at the end of the Veda, because if you look at this Isavasya Upanishad, it is in the right in the middle of the Samhita portion. So, even though it is an Upanishad, it is a Vedanta, it gives the same teaching, it's placed in the Samhita portion. So, it's not necessary that the location is not the meaning of the word Anta. Need not be. So, we can, Antima Nirnaya, we can stick with it. And also, Pujji Swamiji used to say that at the end of the day, after going through the Vedanta portion, if you look back the Veda, wherever Om appears, If that is part of the Nirnaya, like in Mandukya, Omkara is the Agama Prakaranam, and also even in Katha Upanishad, Yamadharmaja says, Bravime, Omiti Aksharam Tad. In the sense, he says that. In the sense, the whole Shastra can be reduced to Sangrahena Pravakshye Omiti Tad. He says that. So, that means Om can be the meaning, and that is appearing all through the Vedas. Wherever there is a Om is there. That means if the Vedanta portion is assimilated by the student or by the all the people who are dealing with the Vedas, so the entire Veda can be called Pramana along with Vedanta, and wherever Om appears, you can bring the understanding of Vedanta into that. So, if you have a look at it, then, like Pujya Swamiji always used to say, Vedanta gives you the view of life. If you have that view, the total view of life, then every other point of view remains a point of view. Otherwise, the point of view becomes a view and threatens you. So, if Vedanta is going to be the view of life, it gives you an overall understanding, Tatparya, Antima Nirnaya of the Vedas, then it is more, every part of life is fulfilling, more fulfilling, and wherever, even when karma is involved, you can do it what is appropriate. Karma can be done as yoga, If Vedanta is the Tatparya of the whole Vedas. So Swamiji always to say that the entire Veda is a Pramana. Antima. Vedanta is only an antima portion or a nirnayak portion. And so the entire Veda is a Pramana. So that is how we used to say. So that way, you know, our life becomes more holistic, whatever we do, wherever we do, in whatever walk of life we are. So that is more so, and also more importantly, like the theme being what is relevant to the society today. In the earlier days, when we say Vedic society, when there were ashrama dharma and everything was prevailing, people were sticking to that structure. And without even understanding the Tatparya, still it is lived by the structure. And everyone knew in their heart of heart, the moksha is the Paramapurusharta, it was so much rooted in the culture and the society. And so that being so, everyone used to live in their walk of life. As per the Varnashrama Dharma, and they were happy. They were not looking for equity outside this moksha. Because everyone is, at the end of the day, Mukta Purusha. That was, may not be very deep understanding, but it was driving. It was at the back of the mind of all the people. So they were not looking for equity. What has happened today is, the structural society is such, that equity we are looking for in every walk of life, gender equality and money equality, comforts equality and all that. And that has created a lot of conflicts. And that is why Swamiji always used to say Vedanta is more relevant today. Because unless this understanding is there, the conflicts in society cannot be minimized. Whatever you may do, whatever good governance or whatever religious practices, everything we install in society, still, that equity, looking for equity which is there in the human, which is troubling the human heart, will continue. So, unless we get this equity from the Sanatana Dharma and Vedanta, that is precisely what we have to take to the society to make it less troublesome, less conflict-oriented. So, that way also Vedanta is very relevant. So it is a theme which is very relevant to society today, and fortunately we have got this subject matter disseminated in various languages, various acharyas are there, and there is a body of knowledge, Prasthanatraya, and there are acharyas who are able to go with the Shankara Bhashyam and disseminate this information methodically to all the people. And there are acharyas who are able to speak in other languages and also take the essence. Okay, through the people who are not that very well versed with Sanskrit and all that, even in various languages, even abroad, people are able to take it, having learned from the acharyas, and they are able to disseminate that in their own local languages, so that people are, and I think more and more it's all happening. I think we have to pray for that to move faster, so that this understanding, reducing the conflict and bringing in equity in one's life by our understanding of Vedanta, we will be able to help the future generations to live a better life, more harmonious life in society. So there is a prayer. So that is what Vedanta is all about. Now, as an explanation, a broad theme, what it is, we have told. Now, when we say Vedanta is a means of self-knowledge, then the question comes, okay, we are talking about Vedanta as something very profound, as the end of the Veda, and Antima Nirnaya, and Vedas talk about all walks of life. And how can be just a means of self-knowledge, can be the essence of the whole gamut of Vedas? How can it be? Self is just one person. Self is me. Then how can my knowledge of me, can be the subserving the interest of the whole humanity? How is it going to happen? So, if you look at as a means, okay, means in Sanskrit what they call it is pramana. Pramana means a few, what do you call, lingas are, linga meaning what? It should not be in this particular, pramana means it is independent. It is not available in other pramanas or other means of knowledge. Anadigatam. Then it is something, it has got a unique message, apurvata. And it is useful. Palavat artha bodhagarbham. It is useful to the society. And also it doesn't contradict other pramanas. And it is abhaditam. It cannot be negated or improved upon. This sort of a the qualification for the word pramana as lingas are mentioned in the Shastra. Now, if you apply all these lingas, you have to say, okay, it is a means of knowledge. It is not the means of knowledge we normally call about means of knowledge as like many, the primary means, eyes and eyesight, ears, hearing, and then taste, sense of taste from the tongue, mouth, and sense of smell from the nose, and sense of sound from the ears. There are primary means of knowledge with which we transact, which every one of us know that that is how, these are all the primary means through which we gather knowledge about whatever we need to do. That's all external. And there is a mind, and which collates the information that is brought about by this primary means, and puts together and make it available for transactions. So this is called Pancha Pramana, five indriyas and five senses, and the mind together. And the mind means can be when the Pancha Pramanas can give you only the pratyaksha, the pratyaksha, what it sees, what it hears, it can. But interpreting that is done by the mind on the basis of the stored information, like even in a computer processor, it goes by its memory and all that, and collates and brings together what is relevant to the given situation and makes it available, like inference, and then anumana, one level, first level inference, second level inference, arthapatti, and presumption, and then vyaptik jnanam, all those things are there. So they are all there, supposed to be the extended pramanas. They are also equally pramanas in the sense, like for example, the typical example is parvadaha vanniman, that is, you see a smoke behind the mountain and you infer that there is fire below. How do you do that? Because in your kitchen, you have seen the chimney, when the smoke comes, there is fire in the below. So there is fire, there is smoke. And smoke cannot be there without fire. So this is the vyapti jnanam. So this sort of an inference also is equivalent to pratyaksha, is equally efficacious as a pramana or a means of knowledge. So, and all our what you call science is the one first level inference, second level inference, connected inference, called the arthapatti. It's all our dashboard in all our cars. And how even a plane, how is it, controls, are all different levels of inference program and program logic controller. So that is again a means of, it becomes a means. Ultimately, it is all inference only and based on pratyaksha originally. So these are all the body of knowledge which we gather through the means of known means of knowledge. Generally, in society, for all subject matter in terms of science or economy, take any subject matter, these are the means of knowledge which we do vyavahara with. Now, we have already committed that Vedanta is the means of knowledge. Now, as I told, as a linga, this Vedanta should not be, what you call, contradicting the means of knowledge which the Pancha Pramanas give. It should be something apurvata, it should give something unique, and it should not be available for this Pancha, by this Pancha Pramana. So those yardsticks or those lingas have to be fulfilled. by Vedanta as a means of knowledge. So now let us look at it, what it is. In a nutshell, like there is a particular statement in the Shastra which says that you are the, instead I am trying to put it in English, I will simultaneously give some Sanskrit equivalent also. The teacher tells, okay, means of self-knowledge we are saying, no? He says, you are the awareful being. This is the simplest way to put it across. You are the awareful being. And Upanishad statement is, all Mahavakyas can say, I am Atma Brahma. In Taittiriya Upanishad, it says, Brahma Vitakma Viparam. In Aitreya Upanishad, it says, Prajnanam Brahma. So these are all the Mahavakyas, Upadesha Vakyas. So it all, when I am talking about all these Upanishad Vakyas as Vedanta as a means of knowledge, it talks about the self and it says it gives you a word. The sense, see, word, these words are also, they are also found in the relative language of, like, we use the tongue, we use the mind, we, all our transactions are through language only. Whatever language we know each other, we transact. Even all this pancha pramana, whatever it, apple, eyesight is English, apple is English, like that. So that's the language, the linguistic, minimum linguistic is there even for the pancha pramanas to express themselves into the what is the knowledge involved. So here also, that much of minimum linguistics is, knowledge is necessary. And there we say that, okay, you are the being, you are the awareful being. In Sanskrit, it will say you are Chaitanyam, you are Satyam, you are Jnanam Anantam Brahma, Satyam Jnanam Anantam Brahma. Like that. See, all the Shabdas. Shabdas means words. Words indicating a meaning. Now, the teacher explains what is Satyam. When he says Satyam, we know in the we suppose we have a glass case, okay, it's a spectacles case. So I see with my eyes form. It forms a pratiti in the retina. And that's all. The eyesight only does that much. Now, the mind, what it does, it brings in from memory, from the earlier experience, that this is not a simple outline like this. It's a three-dimensional plastic case housing glasses. This is what the mind infers. So, once the mind infers and puts it in language, then you say, the vritti is, the jnanam is, this is a glass case. So, this is how knowledge operates. Knowledge operates through the pramana, the object, the pramana, and the prama, the knowledge happens. First instance, only the pratiti happens. And thereafter, the mind infers on the basis of the previous memory and says that this is a glass case. So, that is how the pramana operates. Now, when the acharya, when the teacher tells you, you are awareful being. Now, he also uses the language. Now, you tell me, the sense you know all along, you have been looking at yourself as, who are you? You will say, first you will say your name. Then if somebody probes you further, he will say, I am so and so with so much of height, so much of weight, etc. And probe further, you will say, my location is like that, my Aadhaar card is this, 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 this. This is what we all, in the sense, when you say, who are you? This is what the answers will get from everyone, irrespective of walks of life or whatever it is, intelligent, unintelligent, or what you call, rich, poor, anyone. This will be the answers we will be getting from the people. Now, whereas the Shastra, the Acharya, tells you are the awareful being. See, before this, in the sense, the whole thing, we are now, I'm talking that there is an ambience, we are getting into Vedanta, the person has gone to the teacher to have a self-knowledge, now he is looking for a means of self-knowledge. In that context, the teacher is telling this, and the person is listening to this, the student is listening to this. Now you will say, you will be at a loss, initially you will be definitely at a loss, that I have been thinking all along that I am so and so with so much of height, weight and all that, my relationship, my father and neighbor, etc., etc. All those identifications I was very comfortable with. That's how I have been. But here is the teacher to whom I have asked what is self-knowledge. The sense, he says, you are the awareful being. How to reconcile that? How to reconcile that? How can it make it my knowledge in the first place? Forget about what you call motivate is going to be useful and all. First, I have to understand what he says. Then he says, okay, now you are saying, when I ask you who are you, you are giving your name. I didn't ask your name. I asked you who are you. And you are giving me the name, which is not the correct answer. You tell me who are you. Then you say, I am this body and all. He again says, what is it? I asked you name. I said name is not you. Now you tell me who are you. And you are saying that I am so much of height and so much of weight and all that. I didn't ask what is the weight of your body and what is the height of your body. I didn't ask. I asked you who are you. Then he will be again at a loss. Okay, I am the person who is having this weight, height, and those characteristics, and those relationships. I am the father of so-and-so, neighbor of so-and-so. These are all my coordinates. This is how I am in the society. And that's all fine. That's all fine. That's what you say. You have this relationship. You have this body. You have this thing. And when you probe further, you will say, I am qualified. And you will tell what are your intellectual accomplishments. That is, your mind characteristics. You will say. But, so, you will say the characteristics of your body. You will say the characteristics of your mind. And how far you can say that I play football. How my senses, what are my vibhutis, what are my capabilities, achievements, etc. I will tell you. So, the very fact you are telling all this means they are all what you see as what is objectified by you. In the sense, that is why you are able to very clearly specify all these things, that this is this, 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 all this are I have done like this, these are my relatives, this is what, where I was born, this is my, all the whole story, biography, you will be able to tell on the way, because they are all observed by you or they are all known to you. I am not asking you what is known to you, what are your coordinates and all. I didn't ask. I am asking, who are you? I am asking the person who has told all the story. Then I know what is happening in my mind. I know my relationship. I know my emotions. I know my, achievements. I know my body. I know where I am working, etc., etc. So, I am aware of all these things. Who is aware of all this? Okay, an aware person is aware of all these things. That would be the natural answer. Natural, awareful person, where is he sitting? Yeah, obviously here only, but where exactly? In the mind is a part of the mind. Yeah, immediately you say, yeah, correct. So the whole thing is happening in the mind only. But are you aware of the mind? What is happening in the mind, the thoughts and the emotions and everything? Yeah, I am aware of what is happening in the mind. And also tell me, where is the mind located? No, the mind is located in the brain. How? You say brain and you say it's mind. How can it be? You tell me either brain or mind. No, no, no. Whatever that happens in the brains and the interactions and the thoughts and etc. Whenever the thought occurs, I say my mind is formulating the thought. So, whenever the thought occurs, whenever the thought occurs, the vritti occurs, then there is a mind coming into play. So, there is really nothing called mind as such. The thoughts happen and the mind come into play. So, because thoughts are there, mind is there. Because the mind, okay, whenever the thoughts are coming, you say there is an entity called mind. So, the mind and thoughts are interdependent. And you are observing all of it. And it's all in the flux. So, the awareful person, you cannot say the mind itself is, the existence of it as an entity independent is doubtful. For example, when you go to sleep, where is the mind? Mind is asleep. You are not there. No, no, I am there, very much there. That's why in the next day morning, I say I had a good sleep. But the mind was not there at that time. So how can you say that is part of the mind? You had a good sleep, you had a good dream. Next day morning you get up, suddenly from waking up from the dream and sweating. Then you find you are in the bed. Then you relax, my God, it's a bad dream. So, all those things, the awareful the person is aware of. So, that awareful person is you, that is okay. But you cannot say it's part of the mind and all that. No, no, but I am there also. No, yeah, that is why I am saying. You are awareful and you are being. Yes, I don't deny that. You are being and you are aware. And this is how a teacher, for a person who is having the Shraddha, the teacher who is, in a sense, he has approached the teacher, he knows him, that he is the person who can help me understand. And of course, there is a background why he wants to know the self knowledge, what makes him know self instead of living his life like all along what I have been living. There is a background to it. Definitely there is a background in the sense if something has compelled him. Either he has got, in spite of all his living, properly living with as a Vedic person and doing dharmic life and all that, somewhere along he has got a hit. And the Upanishad says, Pariksha lokan karma chitan nirveda maya brahmanaha nasti kritaha krutena tad vijnanartham guru mevati gache srotriyam brahmanishtam. It says, in the sense, it gives a context. It gives a context where a person approaches a teacher for understanding self. Likewise, different places, different. Then some places it says, Shraddha van labhate jnana. There, Shraddha can be, in the sense, a person, he may not have gone through all these trials and tribulations for him to come to this. He may be a person who is generally interested in truth and who is committed to truth, and once he knows the truth of anything, he lives by that. That may be the natural disposition in life. So he comes across that Vedanta is a, it gives you the truthful understanding of life. Once he has got it through paperback knowledge or through attending some sessions. And he finds that there is an acharya who is talking about it. Then he comes to them. So this is the background. With this background comes, and that is where the dialogue goes on. Who are you? Starts. And the teacher tells, finally, the person who is ready, or a person is very truthful, is not biased by formal, that is called, these formed opinions about life or self or whatever it is. If it is not there, if he is amenable to be open, at the same time, willing to come out with reasons, come out with, he is able to travel along with the teacher in terms of where he is trying to lead him to. Listen, that much of what you call, they, in Kathopanishad, what they call, Kushagraya Buddhi, in the sense, an intellect, which is again, it is Sukshmatamam, in the sense, you must be able to take your, what you call, capability of visualization to a peak level. For that, there should be an infrastructure, in the internal infrastructure, where you have got that. You are able to suspend all your previous notions about life, about yourself. And there is, you are sitting in front of a teacher, whom you have got the Shraddha. He is a person who knows, and he is going to do what he is going to really give me the proper understanding of this knowledge. That sort of a Shraddha is there in the teacher. And what he says naturally at the teaching, and the Shraddha and the teacher and the teaching together, he is able to look at it as a means of knowledge. In this context, the teacher is talking, like, who are you? He started, and he has come to the level where he is talking about an awareful Hindi. Then this person takes it home for the day, or after a few sessions, he understands he is awareful Hindi. Now it has to follow, like, whether it is contradicting any of these other pramanas. Obviously not. A wearful being looks at all the pancha pramana, what at all it is bringing out into the mind, and he transacts his life. Anyway, he has gone home, he is doing everything, he has got hangari, he has got job to do, and he keeps on doing all that. But so, the very fact that doesn't interfere with his life, wherein he has been living with all these pancha pramanas and other science and technology, whatever, it goes on. So, this is not contradicting. So, one criteria is already fulfilled. Like, it doesn't contradict other means of knowledge. And anadikatam. Oh my God. Here is, he is talking about your reality as an awareful person, an awareful being. It is not available for any of these pramanas, because the pancha pramanas which we talked about, he is, this awareful being is seeing. Even the mind or the person, the operating fellow, no, the ego who is dealing with people's relationships and other things, even that fellow, the mind, everything he is seeing. So, naturally it is not available for all those, the ego or the mind or the economics or science or all those pramanas. For all those pramanas, it is not available. Anadigatam, the second, anadigatam meaning not available for other pramanas. That also is fulfilled. Anadigatam, and it doesn't contradict other pramanas. And the third thing is, there is an apurvata. Apurvata, and this is very unique. He has learned something very unique. It is not available elsewhere. And the fourth criteria for a pramana or a valid means of knowledge is palavar artha bodhavatvam, meaning it should be useful. And that is where he will definitely have that question. Now, he will definitely have this question in mind. Okay, I have understood, I am the awareful being, I am going about. In what way it is going to be palavat? In what way? In the sense, all these other pramanas, I am able to do certain things, I am able to go to job, I am able to earn money, I am able to take care of the family and all that. But this knowledge that I am the awareful being, in what way is going to be palavat artha bodhavatvam? Palam, in the sense, it is as a purushartha, as a responsible person living in society, in what way it is making it meaning, my life meaning more meaningful. That palavat artha bodhavatvam, that question mark will be there with him. There again, he had a few sessions and then he went to the Acharya and he explained and tell him that, see, till now, whenever anything That is something very, in the in terms of, in the absence of this knowledge, this understanding that your reality is awareful being, which I have talked about, and earlier, since you thought that I am this fellow, my name is this, my relationship is this, I am this much height, this much weight, and all that, anything and any that identification, anything and everything that is happening in your life, it was affecting that identification. So sometimes you were happy, sometimes not happy. That sort of a buffeting was happening. Whereas now I have told you, your reality is awareful being. And that awareful being is looking at all the, what you call, the affectations, the affected things that are happening to your body, mind, or senses, in your vyavahara, in your, all your walks of life. Now, you are able to, by identifying, by from the learning that you are the awareful being, you are able to see all that is happening with a sense of objectivity. The sense, yes, I am affected by this particular action. I have got less money, I should have got more money. I am seeing that. But it is happening to the, what do you call, so-called person, in terms of this much height, this much weight, this much name, this much this place in society, in the family, etc. That person is having more money or less money. Whereas by the awareful being, in what way it is totally, what do you call, it is no way affected by all these things. So that is the immediate pada. In the sense, you have got an objectivity here, a space between your reality and the so-called transacting person all along. So that is a immediate phalam, and it is not going to change irrespective of what is going to happen. It is going to be the same. It is going to be changeless. And as I have explained, as the teacher, of course, it is only a brief 1 hour session. If it goes further, a lot of things will come up. In the sense, it will say, he will say that it is desa kala vastu aparichinnam. This awareful being is not bound by time or not bound by space. Obviously, it is not object. It is not a thing. When it is not having a time parameter or a space parameter, it is not a thing. But being, you are there as an awareful being, but not proscribed by or not bounded by either time or space or object. You are only vastavam, not vastu. Vastavam means reality. Vastu means thing. You are not a thing, but you are the reality. It is your reality. You are the, that is the self. That is what Vedanta is talking about. So this is the session till now. I have just given a sort of demonstrated that how this can be a means of knowledge and fulfilling all the characteristics of a means of knowledge, and also how it can give a very unique and phalam, in the sense, in terms of, just it makes you free from all the afflictions of your body, mind, sense complex, which you have hitherto thinking that I am the identified person, I and me, myself, the society, as part of the society, I, me, myself, which has been my identification all along, has been put in the observed list, and the being, the awareful being, which does not have a location, which he himself explained when he answered the questions, it doesn't have a location. That means it is not bound by time or space. It's not a thing, but a being. So this itself is, this is a starting point. You can say this is the words. Shabdam Pramanam. Listen, Shabd. Just words. And purely by words, by going through with the teacher with the proper Shraddha and all that, the person get to understand that I am the awareful being, which he has to expand in terms of now he is really that his curiosity and his the sense makes him Palavat Artha Bodhakatvam is there, so that will make him do inquiry further. He will, and without interfering with his day-to-day life, he will, whenever he gets time, he will inquire into this. And the whole gamut of Vedanta, Pramana, Vichara is an expansion of this Shabda Pramanam. So, Shabdam Pramanam is one aspect, and Pramana Vichara is the next expansion. That is, you can do further Shravanam and you can reflect upon it, or you can juxtapose it with the logic and arguments and all, mananam, so that you get it clarified. And then if the whole thing falls in place, if this understanding is there, this awareful being can be contemplated upon. Once you contemplate, being the reality of this self, hitherto unknown, now you are gone. Come to know that at the age of 30 or 40 or 50, and after so many births. So if you look at all the births, suppose 100 births you have taken in the cycle of your life and death. So 100 human births you have taken in between various animal births and all would have taken. So 100 human births are each 70 years. So 7,000 plus now 30. 7,030. At the age of 7,030, you are getting to know that you are the awareful being, not the person who has gone through body, mind, senses with the different bodies, different, taking different births and born is gone, so many things we have gone through. That person is in the sense, the identification with person, that person is gone. And I am the awareful being. Now I have to make it dhridam, since dhrida nischayam, palavat artha bodhakatvam, I have to make it. So that is where the vichara starts. And then you can take to what you call this is okay, this is knowledge. Okay, but every other knowledge I have to apply to make it useful to me. But here it is just a knowledge, it's awareful being, it is not even it doesn't have time, or it's not bound by time or space, or even not even an object. What I can do with it? I can't do anything. I cannot apply. I just know. Yeah, that's true. Then there are two things. Knowledge, generally we say, the order of knowledge is defined by the word epistemology. And the order of reality is defined by the word ontology. Okay, ontology is called reality of orders. Epistemology is reality of knowledge. And if you really look at knowledge, if it is to be falling under the definition, something can be called knowledge only when it is not negated or not available for improvement. If that is the criteria, in the sense, knowledge once, it should stay forever, satyam, it should be. If that is the criteria, look at all the other means of knowledge, whether it is eyesight or whatever you get, or mind, inference, or all that. We know that all along, right from the humanity has evolved for so many millions and billions of years, every knowledge has been either negated or improved upon. That is why so many PhDs on even a small cell research. Even a small cell, a single cell, unitary cell research also has got PhDs still continuing. That means what? There is no finality about any knowledge by any other pramanas. So strictly they cannot be called knowledge. In terms of epistemology, they cannot be called knowledge. And this awareful being is the only knowledge which cannot be improved upon, cannot be negated. So truly, that is why when Jinji said, means of, I said, means of knowledge, Vedanta, means of knowledge, he said, means of self-knowledge. I was hesitant because in my understanding, there is no other means of knowledge other than Vedanta. Every other means of knowledge do not qualify abhaditam satyam. Continuously improving. You are useful for vyavahara, like Mandukya says. Upalabdhi, samachara, upalabdhat, samachara, saprayojana vatvat. Empirically, Swamiji used to say, empirically available, reproducible, transactable. Okay, yesterday you saw, you spoke to Nitinji, today also you are speaking. So that much is there, but he has also undergone change, I have also undergone change. So it is not abhaditam. That knowledge is subject to all lot of parameters. So all within the paradigm, everything is okay. Once the paradigm shifts, everything goes for sex. So in the terms of epistemology, awareful being is the only knowledge that can be called knowledge. That is why I would like to call it as means of knowledge without even comparing with others. And second thing, the reality, ontology, talks about reality. Again, what is reality? Reality is something which cannot change. And if that quality, if that is the yardstick which you are looking at, anything and everything, whatever we are transacting, it is all, you can't say, like the Gita's second chapter itself, Bhagavan says, Nasate vidyate bhavaha, na bhavo vidyate sataha. There again, that's what I was referring to, Vyorabhi drishtantaha. To anayoho tattva darshibihi, a person who is seeing the truth, like even a hasta malaka iva, a person who is seeing the truth without any bias, will accept only this understanding as truth and only this reality as bhava. The sat is only this truth, awareful being. And what is bhava is only this. Everything else is a make-believe bhava. It's all useful. That's all in society. So, that is the apurvata. That makes it the thing in life. And once you are really committed to this understanding, in the sense this growth has to grow on you with your life. And doesn't interfere with your life in any way. You have to keep on learning more and more about it. You will only get, in the sense, it is something like for drinking sugarcane juice, you don't ask for any, what do you call, you don't ask somebody to put sugar on it. So, in the same way, this understanding will only grow if it takes Vishwarupam, it makes your life so beautiful and the life of others also around you beautiful. Because here you will be a person all the time as an awareful being and dealing with the world. And you will be a predictable person because you are operating from the abhaditam satyam and that which is bhava, that is reality in its essence. All the time you will be there and you will be doing things. Plus minus whatever that happens, you will be able to own up and you will be a predictable person. Swamiji used to say, that if you have this understanding, people do not have to deal with you. Otherwise, you have to deal with you. Every time you don't know what is your mood, today one mood, tomorrow another mood, according to the mood, people have to deal with you. Hereism becomes, if not anything else, you become a predictable person. And you are there, protestam all the time like this. And every other thing happening around you, and whatever possible, if it is something that you don't know, you'll go and ask somebody and get to know and do it. And if you have some money, you will share it with others. If you will live within your means. And if you don't get fine, you get fine. Because you are anyway the awareful being. Whatever you do, your taste is not satisfied, your other things are not satisfied, yeah, not satisfied, fine. We'll be objective about you, not satisfied, that's all. It is not that I am not satisfied, I am the awareful being. And I am not bound by time or space or I am not even a thing, I am the being. So nothing has to satisfy me more. So being here, once with this understanding, this is what I was referring to as that. This is the only thing that can bring equity in society. And it isn't really, it doesn't, actually if you are honest, if people are honest, a lot of people Definitely, born in this culture, born with these acharyas around, and all that, this cognitively people do understand this. I don't think, but people are not honest. People don't want to drop the baggage right from the name onwards. Name, fame, money, wealth, ego, all those things they don't want to do. They want to have that and they want to say, I know self knowledge. I know I have read Vedanta, I know. It's beautiful, nice. I want to have this and I will have that also. It doesn't help. It doesn't make you a fulfilled person. There is one more addition to your ego, that's all. It doesn't, that is the only blessing is this, the sense, in a short session I'm talking only this much, but the whole thing is the expansion of this only, owning up and claiming the reality of you as the awareful being. And so many words in English and Sanskrit and in Tamil also, whatever languages people know, can understand, one can communicate. This can be communicated. It's not a big deal. Once a person knows and owns up and claims, and he has no other agenda, then this can be communicated. So that is a blessing, and I think the society, I think all acharyas will be talking about these things in the coming days. They will be able to throw more light on this and make the Sanatana Dharma, which is a talking point these days. It talks about only this, the reality and Abhaditam Satyam. Satyam and reality, no society or no sensible human being can say that I am not one of my reality or one of Satyam. It is not possible. You are the loser by not owning up. So, I think if it is rightly communicated and taken across, can benefit the whole humanity. And that is my prayer for the day and wishes for the whole program to come out successful in making people understand the Sanatana and the Vedanta in its true light. Om Tat Sat. Om. Dayakaram dayakaram dantam dharma pravartakam pranamami dayanandam madacharya varam param purnamada purnamidam purnat purnamudachyate purnasya purnamadaya purnamevavasishyate om shanti shanti shantihi हरिः ॐ श्री गुरुभ्यो नमः हरिः ॐ
Thank you, Swamiji, for that simplified insights on Vedanta for the pursuit of knowledge to lead a harmonious life in today's age in life. It was such a delightfully put. Thank you so much. Thank you, dear viewers, for joining us today. And do join us tomorrow morning also at 7 to 8. We have another session. Can we have the flyer? The topic on tomorrow's morning topic is Karma in the Light of Shankaracharya's Commentary by Swami Japasiddhananda Ji. Thank you.